So, beginners? If anyone of you is a Pandas user or developer, you feel free to go to another session. So, Joseph Dugan, you're a junior developer.
Why do you want to watch you?
Nice. So, I'm not a big fan of PowerPoint presentation because I think they're pretty boring. But nevertheless, I mean, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 slides. To show some stuff. First thing, most of you perhaps remember it or not. It's year 2004. It is Mambo, the father of Joomla. So this was one of the before templates that came with Mambo. And another default template is the template everyone could see before was SolarFlare. And this was everything in year 2004. And the next year, things changed pretty fast, and it was a dramatic change. So we got Joomla. And as you can see, the both templates, they have the same. They have the same stuff in it. And 3 years later, in 2008, we got Joomla 1.5. And there we go. This is the standard template that you've all seen with Joomla. And if we go further, you can see the Beast template. It's a perfect demonstration for a corporate website. The Beast template may look funny, but it demonstrates the power of Joomla 1.5.
I think that the good thing about Beast is the support overall.
Overall, exactly.
Table it overall.
Exactly.
And gradual answer.
And when we go to year 2010, we see one of the default templates that came with Joomla 1.6, beta 1. And this is how it looks. Do we have beta 2 already? Or Joomla 1.6 beta 2? No, it's not that. So, do you see something in common?
It's boring.
It's boring.
I mean, the layout, from my point of view, from what I'm seeing here, it looks quite similar. You know, the logo space on top of both columns and sides and.
Well, this is pretty much standard. The user expect to see everything in those positions.
I'm sure on the bottom, you know, maybe in the back end, things are.
No, if you look at Mambo and Joomla 1.0, the difference in the back end was only the logo. Like everything else was the same.
So why did they change it from Mambo to Joomla? I mean,
in the color.
In the color, yeah. The logo and the color was the only difference between Mambo and Joomla 1.0. So the developers decided that they cannot stick with this company Miro something, and they split it up and made Joomla out of it.
Okay.
So all the disadvantages that Mambo had stuck in Joomla 1.0. And in previous years, when you make a new website with Joomla 1.0, then most of the time you have to pack the core files to make something work the way you want it.
I come with 1.5 levels, so the legacy things.
That's a good thing that we're not.
But then again, I get really confused because not a lot of components saying some of the components that I like, they say they're from version 1.0. So then I go into I enable legacy in order to install them. But then when I enable legacy, my 1.5 doesn't work. Okay. So, you know?
The framework between 1.0 and 1.5 is completely different. The extensions use this legacy plugin so that they can work with 1.5. But most of the time, the legacy plugin is not enough, so you have to rewrite your own extension for 1.5.
Yeah.
And as I said, the new framework in 1.5 gave the developers a lot of possibilities, and that's why we saw, I believe in 2008 we had around 2,000 extensions, 1,900, and today there are more than 5,000. So in 2 years we got so many extensions, and some of them are really great. The thing is, while making this presentation, I was making a plugin for my comment system. so that it can work with components such as virtual mat or something else. And I don't remember the company that I was working on. And I was pissed off because I had to find where the view is, and I had to hack it to include my code so that I can call my component. And the thing is, the developer didn't know that in Java 1.5 we have something called plugins. And on this place, he could just fire an event that can call, and I can use this event to call my code, so I don't have to do anything with this component. And another thing is that after I made this plugin for the comment system, then I was working on a website, and the website was made from other people, and I saw pretty good hacking all around, and I thought, what for template overrides? And so, as we saw with the template that I showed already, they look pretty boring, and we have customers that want templates like this. So, that template, there's no fancy CSS or anything. The thing with it is that this is the front page. And as you can see, you have a small column on the left and two columns that are the same width. But the thing is, when you go to the articles, to a single article, the width of the column in the middle changed to this. As you see, it's around 200 pixels bigger than before. And that's not the only problem. If you go back to the front page, when you build a Joomla website, we should figure fast what are we doing. Is this a module? Is this a component? Is this a plugin? How are we going to structure the web page? So here, what you see is that on the left, you have a small picture, a thumbnail. When this website was built 2 years ago, there was no K2 and the other content component extensions, they were not good. So this thing is based on the content, and it uses some modules to pull the content and show it in this way. So we have the three first articles there showed with some teaser text and a thumbnail. And what you see in the clamber there are some numbers that are the comments made for this specific article. If we look back to our template that I showed it to you, such thing is not possible. You cannot make it out of the core. Because if you put if you use some content and you want to put a picture in your article, so you put the picture in it, but the picture can only show in the together with the content and not on the left side of the content and on the left side of the article title. So you can use tricks to make this, and it's pretty easy if you know them, and you don't have to go to install K2 or another such component to make this website. So if you have a client that have just small specifications, he doesn't need something big, then you can give him content and he will be really happy with it. You don't have to configure K2 and make a template for it. You just can use content. As I said, on the next page, you have the article. And this small picture here on the left, the thumbnail, is the same picture that you saw previously on the same height with the title. Another problem with this template is that this picture here, it is not it's not a banner. It's not published in this position. It's actually this JoomlaWorks gallery that when you write your article, you include a specific plugin and write plugin layer, JoomlaWorks folder, etc. And normally displays here in the content. So we had to find a way to put it on the left side, specifically in this position, and at the same time put the models down. The next problem with this template was that you have the latest file news in this category here. But the thing that you don't see on this page is that when you go when you click on this category here, then you get a list, so then you get to have a list with all the articles for the previous 6 months, and 1 year, 2 years, and you can jump over the years. But you don't have the latest five in this category. And the thing is, with Joomla, when you have a menu, every menu has an item ID. So if you have a menu structure like this, so this menu item, this is the home menu item, it has an item ID 1. So when you publish a module, it doesn't matter what extensions are showing on the home page, the older the module will be shown on this page. And it's exactly the same thing with the gallery, category there. So we have a category here. It has an item ID 10. If I have a right module position and I publish the latest articles in this position, then it should normally show the category and the article. And it doesn't matter what you show, that it should be there. And the thing was to find a way to use the normal Joomla content and show different stuff. So, I don't know how many of you have ever built a template. It's pretty easy.
There must be some sort of first-party tools that I can, for example, take this gentleman's template and then load into my little gadget and I can change the width and positions and...
Nowadays,
it's not a tool that works, because there's one that doesn't work that I installed last week. It is with AR
artistic.
Yeah, that, I don't know. It didn't work for me.
Artistic, yeah, that's a pretty name.
Yeah. No, I don't know, but it didn't work for me very well. It says you can create templates for Joomla, for WordPress, for ASP. I've created some,
But with artistic, you get the same effect with the Mambo and Joomla 1.0. The templates are the same.
No, I mean, what I'm saying is that the artistic programs, they work. It looks fantastic in my lab as a preview, but when I save the template and upload it.
What did happen? What did happen?
The graphics and everything else, I can show you later. It's still here.
I believe it's the case for.
It's an evaluation copy, so it's got a watermark saying evaluation or something. But, I still expect it to look the same as the preview before I saved it, before I packaged it as a template.
Yeah, the thing is, what components do you have on the website?
There was no components, it's very, very straightforward, I took one of the templates and just...
Okay.
There's no...
You
can take it offline.
So, I have... Really small template. It's called simple template, and imagine that is a template for a big company or so. The thing that I would do normally is when I install the new template on my website, and I will probably go and make changes to it. So I will copy the template that's been installed and will paste it in the templates folder. And I will rename it to something that I want to use. So I will say that it's a Jeff template. The only thing that you have to do is to change the file names here. But in this case, only the name. Everything else will stay the same. This is a standard installation file for templates, so we can do this, make those changes and everything's ready. And when we log into our backend of the site, you can restore your update and compare the files that have changed and then take on the changes that you need. So it won't break anything that you made. We'll select this file and choose the standard one. And when we go to the front end, we'll see some content. It looks pretty ugly. So the file that is called is the index.php file. The first line, as you can see, it in every index, in every PHP file with Joomla, and it is important for the data. Define JX or restricted access. It is there. If somebody tries to directly call your PHP file, you will normally get an error, and it can reveal potential unsecured data that you can use to get your website. So if this line is there, and you guys try to directly call this file, then you will get only restricted access and nothing more. So
if I do whatever, let's say, coca-cola.com/index.php.
No, that's not the right PHP file. Okay. This index PHP file resides in templates, and this is JEP template, and and then you have index. So we get restricted access. When I remove this thing, then the template will be executed, and you see stuff like this.
I've seen a lot of these, especially in photos. Okay, so I've learned something new.
So, the next line is normal HTML. And we go to this line here. We have a little bit of PHP, and you just print a string on the page, or this language. What you print out is the language that you use on your website. This one. So what this does is it calls the JDocument object. And the J, if you want to have a look at it, it resides in libraries in the document. HTML and JavaScript. So everything you can put everything this title, for example, or description, or whatever, and it will show the information in the JDocument object. In our case, when you go further in our template, we have this language again, and here's the head. I'll talk about this construct later. We have the base URL of our website that's printed out, and what I have here is this template. This will we call the name of our template, check template, and we call the So when I go further, we see those JDoc include elements. These are standard Joomla tags that will render some element on our web page. As we saw here on the top, we have the head. If I remove those things and leave the website like this, you will see an empty body with no text in it, but you will still see the welcome to Joomla. This is because the JDoc head puts all the CSS files, JavaScript files, etc. that you need. For example, you use 20 components and
then I worked out how to take that offline, because we have a couple weeks ago.
So, and we have the same thing with modules. We have a type module to load the modules in a specific position. That's our position in the top. And we have the type component that will render the component in the selection code. So we have the home page. We've said that the home page is content. Then you see the front page view of content. And I believe here would be the place to talk about overrides. So, do you know what MVC stands for? MVC.
I heard that.
Okay, so you don't have to know a lot about it. It stands for modular controller. And what we're interested in when we speak about templates is the view. And so every component in 1.5 has a view. And it can have several views. And I'll show you that if you go to components and look at content, you will see the views folder. Here are where all the views are stored. So every we have articles, archive, article, category, convention, section. So every view has a layout, and the layouts are all stored in template. So a view can have multiple layouts. And so right now we are on the front page. We are on the front page, and what we render right now is the front page view of the com articles component. So what we see outputted here is, are the things that you have in views, front page, and the default page view. So if you want to change this thing, if you want to do this latest update or to make this H1 or H10 or whatever, and you can just go to this view, to the default template, and remove it from here. So what you can do, for example, is let us look at a title, for example.
Right now it is the one that is staying in the
in HTML and content on page. So you can do this for category, for article, for every view that you want to.
Well, I wish this was the first presentation on Sunday morning. By now, you know, I've discovered myself again. I mean, don't get me wrong, I've been learning like web pages, you know, based on HTML or ASP for a little while. I just couldn't work out how the Joomla works on the bonnet, but now this. It's no longer magic.
So, this is about overrides, this is the way that they work. We have also overrides for modules, and they work the same way. So if you have, if you look at our front page, what are we using right now? There must be a model. So let us make it a little bit nice. It's also not a good thing to use values like this blue and white in the CSS file because every browser interprets it in different ways. So it's better to use the RGB
there. Things that we see often is that in different views and different overrides, we need all different functions. For example, if we want to show only the first 500 symbols of something, of some text, long description, then we use ambient, substring, and use a function, each function that does that. And we will do this in every single file. Thing is, we want to first check is this text bigger than 500 symbols. If it's bigger, then we'll cut it. If it's not bigger, then we won't cut it. And then we see people going to those override files, and they will write at the bottom PHP and write function crop, and the actual code goes here, and they will do the same thing in all files over and over again. And instead to repeat yourself all the time, you can just write a small plugin and copy the plugin to the place where you want it. So when you do a website for a customer, you say, I use the same functions on 10 different files. I don't have to write the same function in those 10 files. I can write it on one place and use it in all those files. So I have laid down the structure for this. If you go to plugins, like this, I made a new directory, jet library, and we have a jet functions PHP and a XML file. The XML file in general looks nearly all the same. The first line, the install line, says that what the version of the component is, or what the type it is, plugin or module or component. And it says for plugins we have an additional type, what you have to write is our group. And this is exactly the folder this is residing, the plugin is residing in. And the name, auto, creation date, copyright, license, all the name, just all things that are understandable from themselves. Description, the file names, that is all. So once we've made this thing, then we can zip this file and install it in our journal. So what I'm going to do, open this installation, I'm going to the settings folder, and I'm going to zip this folder. Zip those two files. Those two files because we get error messages from the channel framework, and then we can go to the packet again and install our plugins. Plugins install this takes 5 minutes to make it, and it makes your life much easier. So the only thing that you have to do is go to the plugin folder and search for your plugin.
C library.
Fourth entry from the bottom.
It's enabled, and if we go to this utility function, where is this called? Check functions. So, here's our plugin. It's pretty simple. It has again this line that we can use on the template. And it's a standard class with several functions in it, and I will talk about this function here. It was the, if you have a normal text and you want to crop it in some place, then you say the text that goes through the function and the length of the function, and the only thing that you have to do in your template, for example, is to
thank you.
page. It's a stupid example.
Maybe you need the items feature.
Sorry?
Maybe you need the items feature.
Yeah, it's in that reason, yeah. But I don't know if I go to the items feature, we have to copy it to the new folder, so
yeah,
I want to include that numbers. And we make it to this PHP. And what we have to do is to call the J clothing helper. The name of our class.
There is no
standard way of calling CSS file from an extension, which means that the template cannot simply say, do not load the CSS file in your file. So the only way to load CSS file from a template is to override what is already loaded.
That's
well, the best thing you can do actually is like go through the standard Joomla, say CSS, and make your own. And that will override a lot of components or extensions, but not everything. You will be doing overrides anyway on CSS.
That's what I've kind of been doing.
What you said at the beginning is that about this jglut type head, that you figured out how to use it and to remove CSS from it.
Yeah.
So basically what you want is that when I saw my extension, that it doesn't load CSS in the head of your website, or what were you trying to say?
Okay. I'll show you a very basic example. Can you go to your Mac?
I don't see the next one.
The best thing you can do is just take the CSS out and see how it looks. And so you see how much Joomla has in the CSS.
It's a lot. I mean, it's, you know, it scrolls forever.
If you want a quick tip for figuring out the best way to write CSS files, you can load your page in Firefox and have Firefly.
Yeah, I'm going to show you this. Here's the way we make it. There's an extension to Firefox. You can install it from the show Firefox repository. And it's placed here at the bottom of the bug. So if you click on it, this is how it looks. It loads in your browser. And you click on this symbol here. So, and select any element of the page. So, for example, if we go to this thing here, you will see that this is the element, Joomla Community Portal, and this is the table that's residing. So, you can see the styles that it has applied from my template.
I mean, that's for more or less I've been doing and copying it and going to the component style sheet and, you know, overriding the component style sheet to the style sheet of the template.
Sometimes it helps to remove the component style sheet first to the naked component and then add a single style sheet file just for your component within
based
your template.
Yeah. Okay.
I had to do this several times. Yeah. Each component I use, it doesn't fit in my template, so I remove the component.
Well, this is not really complicated, it's time consuming.
But it is time consuming.
Yes.
You have to understand
that. Somebody has to understand CSS.
There is Warp, there are some frameworks there where you can play with it. There's one I think is called Warp, and the other one is called...
This is from Joomla Junkie.
And there are two or three tools that where you can actually say a little bit like I just here, but made specifically for Joomla templates.
Yes.
Where you can play a little bit.
There are actually many more template frameworks in the Joomla Community Magazine, which we'll be launching in the next 1 week or so. We have,
End of the month.
Okay. We'll be reviewing the first four template frameworks and more will follow. So you will see how you can use these things to speed up creating a template. Kung has a very great template framework.
I'm a loyal follower of this guy. So,
sure, you're really good.
But there are 3, 4, 5 tools
that
you can use to do that, and it's more visual actually.
I don't want to mention Microsoft just in case this.
Just say hi to Microsoft. Conversation is recorded anyway, so they can find
it. Recorded for evidence. I wouldn't see from page 98 back in the day.
Yes, in 1985, something like that.
1998. You can actually more or less,
what you see is what you get.
Yes,
there are some tools that you can install on your website that you can move, for example, the modules around. So if you take the module that's published in the left position and then put it on the right position. And there are some templates that also give you the possibility to
change
that. I mean, we release tree-free, you know, mm-hmm. with already several layouts.
But I don't recommend using those tools for making a website, like Dreamweaver or even like Fiverr and even like what do you say, WAP frameworks.
But I don't know.
Yes, Morphe.
Morphe. Yeah.
It's a visual interface, mm-hmm. but I don't think a good template must be hand coded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, okay, you can do this stuff with this stuff for very quick job. And it's quick and dirty, but I don't trust a quick and dirty job for professional work.
What I believe is that it is true that you can do nearly anything with Joomla, but the small stuff, the small websites with 5 pages, contactors, etc. You just give a template and it's looking okay and so on. And for these pages, it's okay to use Morphe, etc. to make this page because they won't have any traffic, etc. But if you're building a big website, you have to have resources to put the template yourself.
What I was talking about is basically me, you know, going to a customer and then he asks for like a visual prototype, not a function prototype. So something like being able to move columns around and everything else, you know, kind of show him the look and then give that to the template developer so can you actually create something from scratch that
so
will
be
a
touch
code
just to show to
techniques.
Anyway, when you
move your pants,
you should better answer it. I think it's good. Yeah, you save time or you know you are architecture, right? So you should focus on on your architecture and set up system, set up template, set up the layout, everything. So you can just get someone to do the job because it's talking about five or less, and you can just also do the other work. And my job is doing that.
Listen, when I work in Europe, I can get a pen and paper, and I can say to people, look, we're gonna have this, okay? But then, most of our work is in Africa. And if African people is like, they wanna see it, then they believe it. Mm. When I say to you, I can make you a glass, I don't see it. You know? You go in, Do you understand?
Okay.
Literally.
That's different.
My 3 months project took a year. I mean, don't get me wrong, like, I've been compensated for a year. But something that I would do in the UK or in Sweden or in Germany or somewhere else would be 3 months over the phone. You know? It's like, so this is why, I mean, even something that can go to the project and say, there you go, guys. And they see big smiles, money changes hands. That way I can, you know, say, Daniel, there's, you know, £5,000.
I mean, you need to do functional layouts, as you do, send it to you. I work with Africa a lot too.
Okay.
I do not really agree with what you say, but it's okay. It's your experience.
I mean, South Africa is, you know, but I work in Nigeria.
Yeah, but we work with Congo, with things. So I've also experienced with Africa, Senegal, or other countries. And actually, you need to give them, put the paper, you scan it. You scan it. You do it like this first, and they say, "This is going to be there." Then they say, "Oh, but we want it pretty." Let's work. So we can do it pretty. We can put a nice CSS, whatever a real designer comes, and then even moves a little bit, like increases the search box, whatever. That's like user interface, right?
Do you know? Do
but
you
that's
wireframe.
Wireframe.
Wireframe. The wireframe is this. Okay? Look at this.
Okay.
And there are rules, a lot of where you say, okay, this is, I have so many columns, I have so many...
That's a grid system.
Okay, grid, so then you start wireframing in your grid.
And then what I want to say is that when you're sitting together with a customer, you can write anything on a piece of paper, but if you want, you can use software for this.
I mean, this is what I've been doing. I've been going, getting a screenshot of the website, then cutting bits out, and then open another, not create a JPEG and paste in it. It says, look.
Yeah, exactly.
That's
wireframe.
That's
wireframe.
Okay.
There are programs for this that you won't have to make a JPEG and move the things with JPEG in Photoshop or whatever. You have a program for it that has a text block, it has a login box or a button, etc. And you just pick the button, place it there, and the customers see there is a button. Mm-hmm.
it doesn't look the way it's going to look at the end.
Okay, so this is what the gentleman was saying in building a complex website.
Yeah, sure, sure, that's the one. Yeah. Oh.
But you know what? It's also time consuming.
And what I think that you are, okay, you are a user, artistic is perfect for WordPress. But it's not a template producer. Artistic is having agile and okay, it's good, but it's good for like wireframe. Okay, you want to move this bar to the left, make it red, okay, then you try to picture your immigration and then you can pass to the design. Okay, I want something like this. And you can make it better. So you can use artistic, I think.
What I don't like about artistic is I've looked into the code and they write pretty much unnecessary code to stuff.
It's like no from page 19. If you look at the code that from page 19 creates nonsense, there's so many artisans in it.
Yeah.
It's not a nice clean tight code, it's just
anyway, that is one of my first software that I used to create my website.
Sure.
Front page. 7 years.
Netscape
was good, but
yeah. But then Microsoft steals everything. It's the power of marketing, I guess. They had large marketing, you know, strategy for more money.
The name of your session?
Yes, it's what can we...
You can do everything, but it takes time. It takes preparation, and actually, there are, if you really want to go like full professional in Joomla, all the way, you see, you can't be alone anymore, because you can't make a living out of it. It's too complicated.
I like to share it, you know, with my...
Oh, you need to share it, because you need to be a CSS specialist, you need to be a component specialist, you need to be an
extensions, whatever. I mean, work out the graphic design out to make
it really...
No, it's a thing, no. Oh, I have no intention of going anywhere wrong.
No. Just,
you know. I know exactly what you're saying.
I think you are in the same box as mine, because I'm not good at coding, I have to say. I'm not very good at design. Okay, I can do the job. I quit the job some long time ago. I know someone can do it well, so I bring them together. So I just like a delegation work and do the thinking. Okay, I give them the concept, give them the requirement, and I put the right person in the right procedure. We make it done, and even we make it complete. I think it's take time, it's take a little bit time, but it's have a very good product. I think I do like shape the time for making my own business, doing the thing that I'm the best and give it a walk to the other. So I think you can, but nowadays you use your muscle as well?
As you said, the guy for CSS that is basically through CSS and maybe PHP, HTML, but definitely someone who's got eye for colors, graphic designer.
But they're not the same though, there's a PHP and CSS. They try to talk together, but
those guys are not a bit of CSS. CMPP guys are friends.
Or CSS and HTML person.
Yeah.
That could be quite...
This guy do the both now, but I rarely see. This is I do the both KP and CNN and everything, but in my team, they're different people. And even the design, I want to do the CNN, leave that job to me, because I'm going to take that job to give someone else. So you focus on the design. Yeah.
What do you think?
I was asking about the ITMB. This topic is interesting to me. You started out with ITMB, is there okay? So,
every page in Joomla has an ITMB ID, and the ITMB ID is the idea to have for
mentioned something with the module, the latest 6 articles.
And the latest 2 to 5 views in the category. So as we can see, let me change the template to something else. So it's a little bit more organized. So, general overview is an article, and analysis is an article, FAQ is a section. Okay. And this here is category. So if you look at the item ID here, that's the item ID. So when you choose an article from this list, the item ID will be still 46. So you won't have the possibility to show different things on the pages.
Because it's always the same.
And the trick that we did back then was we used template override for this view here. So we called the templates, we made a special template module position in this overview. And we call this, for example, category position. And we published modules to this category position for this manual, for 46. And when you go to the category layout, then the override will load your modules to this position. But when you click on the article will have another override, and this other override will give it a different name, and then you can load specific modules for this override. And it's pretty easy how it works. Category. So what we can do is in this specific position we can write a little bit of PHP and say there is a Joomla function called jhelper-modules, and you can use get-modules to get and you can define positions, so for example category position. This should take all of your modules position to the category position. We will publish some modules in this position. So we have the footer.
How many websites do you guys have?
What kind of website?
It doesn't matter in general. Around how many websites are you running? 2, 3, 10, 15?
Nine sites or
five websites?
My own websites.
How old is our command website on the website we provide a bit on?
Were any of those websites hacked?
Yes. I have a demo site. I provide full access to the admin inspectors, and there are guys who are trying to upload something and to get my server information.
I believe that Nicholas wants to show us what to do in a case our website is hacked and all the data is stolen, and he wants to show us how to use a Kiva backup.
Oh, yes. Is this?
Do it at time.
Okay,
but
yeah.
Is that you?
Yeah.
It's him.
Let me tell you something before I discover it in my car.
Inside your in a predefined location inside your administration area. It is secured using a .hst access file, which doesn't allow access from anywhere, but it is an old location. So what I always tell people to do is do not start a backup, even though you can. First, go to configuration. And go to the other directory and choose something different.
Yes.
So now for this example, I would just, I think Sam has one directory which is readable.
It's Windows, everything's writing.
I would just use one random directory. On your own server, you just have to create one directory, a single level higher than your web root. So if your web root is inside the public HTML folder of your account, just create one directory on the same level as public HTML and maybe something like backups, security, safety, anything you like, and choose this one over here. You just navigate directories, okay?
The thing is that the folder should not be accessible from outside.
Yeah, there should be absolutely no way for someone over the web to access this directory.
I mean, you know, otherwise
this is no problem with one having a website on a different server, shared hosting where I can't.
You can, of course. And you can use the default directory. You can use one directory inside Joomla, but the best security practice is that if you have this option to create a directory outside Joomla, do it. Otherwise, you can just use the default.
Is there a way of putting a password on the backup file that's created that have a zip or G's?
Right now in this version, there is no provision for providing the password. With the Kiba Backup 3.1, there will be 128-bit encryption. So you will have your password protection.
You know, I would use, it's not very trusting environment, so.
Yeah.
Nobody uses PayPal, pay one guy, whatever, bag of rice, and it will go, and he's got access to that, and he will take that backup and pass it to the next newspaper.
Yeah.
And before you know they both through the same different logo. I mean, I've seen that before.
Yes,
so
it always happens.
So
there will be password protection. Once the 1.6 goes live, there will also be ACLs in place. You can keep a backup. So you can define one backup operator who can only take a backup. He cannot access it. He cannot download it from inside the component. He cannot change your configuration parameters. So once you have defined your password, he cannot retrieve it, and he cannot download the file, so you're a bit more secure against this kind of insider attack.
I mean, at this stage right now, I make sure I'm the only person that does the maintenance, I'm a maintenance contract.
If you're using the professional version of the component, this is the core version, the free version. If you're using the professional version, there's an option to upload your backup files to FTP or S3 or Dropbox. Now, with Dropbox, you don't have real security, but if you're using FTP, you can have a write-only FTP account.
Right.
So you can upload all your backup files automatically to remote FTP location, and you don't have to worry about it because there is no backup on the server. Yeah. If you're using S3, you can do the same thing. You can create a secondary account which has write-only privileges on the S3 bucket, so your backups can be stored on S3 but cannot retrieve using the same credentials. So once the configuration is over, you can just save it. And the only thing we have to do really is click on backup now.
Before we go to your backup now, we have the configuration screen. I told you this on Skype. What I missed there is this exclude folders. And the thing with exclude folders is on the control panel of the extension. It took me some time to do it.
There are two two important things. You can exclude files and directories and database tables.
I have some folders on my website that have videos in them.
you don't want to back them up every time. Exclude the directories very simply, just not only files and directories, exclusion back.
I'll tell you what, I've done the crazy thing initially. I've installed it, correct?
Yeah.
I mean, now I've spent a good few hours to flick through. But initially, I installed the product backup now. And I'm thinking, fixed backup is like, 500 megabytes, how come?
Yep.
And then I realized when I looked at the default,
Let's say I want to exclude the XML addressing directory. There are three icons on the left. The first one excludes the directory completely, it doesn't appear in our backup. The second one skips up directories, will include this directory and its files, but not everything underneath it. Also, directories will be gone. And alternatively, we have the third icon, skip files, which will back up all the subdirectories, but not the files on that specific directory. So I want to exclude completely this directory, so I just click on the leftmost icon. The background turns to yellow, and now this will be automatically excluded for every backup I make. And I can do the same thing with files. I can exclude some of the changelog copyrights, credits, all the installation notes, and the license files, because there's no need for them to be inside my backup. You can also exclude subdirectories or subdirectories, because it is very easy to navigate. You just click on the directory, and you see all its contents. When you're done, just click on back.
Yeah.
It takes a while. It's on a very fast level. And you can do the same thing with database tables. Here we have a list of all tables. Now, each table has two icons on the left. The first one is exclude this. It completely ignores this table from the backup set. And the other one, it is do not backup its contents. So the structure of the table will be in the SQL down, but not its contents. And as you see, there's one table whose contents are already excluded, session tables. Because when you restore your backup, you don't want any session data to survive. Let's say that this is done automatically, you don't have to worry about it. Because let's say that you were logged in on your site and your site crashes, and you need to restore it. If you had the session data, you wouldn't be able to log in. You have to delete your cookies from your browser and log in again.
So that's selected by default?
Yes. And you see that it has a different background color, it's red, which means that you cannot touch it. If I click on it, nothing will happen. No action. It is just like that, you can't change that. It is the automatic exclusion. So let's go back. And just click on backup now. On this page, right before we start the backup, we can give a short description. This is only for ourselves. It appears on the backend so that we know why we took this backup. By default, it includes the date stamp. And we can add a backup comment. The backup comment is a more lengthy description, which also appears in the backend administration. And if you're using zip files, it will also be the comment of the zip file. But generally, it is a bad idea to use zip files, especially on shared hosting. If you have dedicated hosting, we might guess. But on shared hosting.
I know when you basically try to use zip file, which is this kind of warning.
Because zip files need to calculate seriously checksums, seriously 32 checksums.
So
they take a very long time to calculate, especially for large files. So if you're on shared hosting, which is dead slow, and you try to do this kind of CPU intensive calculations, you will probably get a timeout error.
Oh, plenty. I mean, I used to kind of, you know, go for zip and was timing out on the big size.
You can test the default setting of the JPA format, which is more or less the zip format without the search and search option.
I'll tell you what I haven't tried. I haven't tried a situation where, let's say, I've assumed that, you know, the website went down. I've got the FTP copy on another machine, and let's say I go to the location where my stuff being hosted. I look at the rack, there's just empty space and cables sitting out. So I think you would like to put a new server in. Would I be able to, provided obviously the new server is in the same configuration, the same IP address, the same setup, would I be able to just restore it straight back and then?
Yes. The backup file has everything you need to restore your site. So from there or better, you just need a web server. You don't need to have Drupal installed, you don't need to have a Drupal backup installed.
You just extract the files into the backup and run the URL.
It has all your site's files, the dump of your site's database, and the installer script inside your head. It is completely self-contained. You can just copy your backup files to a CD-ROM, to a flash memory, and keep it in a safe. And if your site goes down, you can just take this medium, upload the easy file to your new server, and there you have it, a full site restored. So the backup is very easy. You shouldn't have to do it. I would just wait. Since this is Windows, I guess it will take about 1 minute to back up the entire site. You can ask me questions in the meantime.
Just a single question. Shadow, same integrated, automatic update, not update, backup,
cron jobs, yeah. Well, there are actually 3.5 methods to create a cron job for a Kiba backup. One method is using the front-end backup mode, which is available in the free version. There are full instructions on our website and in the documentation. You can also download the documentation in PDF format if you prefer offline reading. There are two different backup methods in the professional release, which are much faster. And there is also the option to install the Maximal RPC plugin and use a piece of software we have created, a Kiba remote control, where you can back up simultaneously many sites from your desktop.
I will look into that.
Yeah. It's very convenient, especially if you are managing 10, 20, or 50 websites. You just click on backup all, and there you have it. You just sit back and enjoy it. Everything gets backed up, and you're okay, backup's done. And now the backup's over, let's just go to the backup files, and we see that the backup is there. This is the description we have chosen, which by default included the date and time. We also have the date when the backup started, how long it took the backup for the next section or for this machine. The status here, okay, means that the backup is complete and the backup archive is on our server. Now there are some few other statuses that you can see. Obsolete means that the backup was complete but the backup archive is no longer on the server, and failed, which means of course that something went very wrong and you have to resolve it as soon as possible. And the last one is pending. When you see pending, it means that the backup is still running. And in this case, do not click back. Do not go to the Kiba Backups control panel because it will just stop the backup.
Another question. I've got a website which has been updated 24 hours a day. Four guys sitting down adding news all day long.
Yeah.
I mean, right now it's got like
my own site too.
300,000. See, if I run a backup, let's say twice a day, how does it affect those people adding articles? It just separates.
Well,
or should I load them between for this half an hour?
No, don't it. When you run the backup, it takes some server resources to perform this operation. So your site might be a bit slower. Otherwise, it is still fully functional. Another thing is that we have never observed data corruption, even on our site, which is updated 24/7, literally, because we have a forum and people from all over the world. Yeah,
different times, right? Basically.
Yeah. So there is never a quiet time to take a backup.
MySQL server resolves the queries and so on.
Yeah, the statistical probability of corrupt data is almost non-existent. At worst, you may find that an article may be logged when you restore your site, but not completely lost. So
maybe one or two or five articles doesn't log. They would be.
Oh, otherwise,
sometimes have to charge for.
There's a problem. There's a good thing about Joomla. It performs some very smart and very atomic operations in the database. It doesn't try to update 20 different tables just when you create an article, or five tables when you just view an article, unlike Joomla, for example. So this kind of Joomla behavior eliminates the possibility of data corruption. It doesn't update too many tables at once, so for the half second or 1 second that it takes to back up an entire table, nothing changes.
So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Daniel.